Rome, an imperial holy city. Ivan brought in the finest architects from Italy. He charged them to raise monuments to God's glory and Moscow's power.
The Kremlin becomes a sacred Christian center. That is where the great cathedrals of Moscow are built. You might liken it to the imperial city in Beijing and the Chinese emperor's sacred inner city.
For a finale, Ivan's architects enlarged and restructured the Kremlin fortress itself. They encircled it with stone ramparts 16 feet thick and crowned by 19 towers. A royal city within the city, filled with palaces, armories, and churches. In the endless lands outside Moscow, Ivan the Great also began to change the rules of life for Russia's rural majority. Once, peasants had been free to farm wherever they found open land. By paying tax or tribute, they could grow crops on fields belonging to noblemen or the church. If the land grew tired or taxes too heavy, the farmers moved to greener pastures. Tsar Ivan issued decrees crippling the peasants' traditional right to roam. Now, only once a year, in the depths of the frigid Russian winter, could peasants leave one landlord for the fields of another. The peasants were not yet serfs, slaves bound to the land, but Ivan had begun their journey into bondage. Ivan's death in 1505 would bring his son Vasily to the throne. And perhaps the most historic act Vasily Ivanich would make was not as an empire builder, but as a lover. Behind the gates of a convent, the prince locked away his first wife, Salomea. She had failed to give him a child, and so he took a new bride, Yelena. The Orthodox Patriarch of Jerusalem condemned Vasily's sinful second marriage.
You will have a wicked son. Your states will be prey to terror and tears. Rivers of blood will flow. Your cities will be devoured in flames.
The patriarch's fearful prophecy would prove all too true. August 25th, 1530. The omens were awesome at the birth of Prince Vasily's son. Legend says the sky split open and lightning struck the Kremlin. The night Ivan IV, heir to the Russian throne, was born. Bells spread the news across the land. Far to the east, a Tatar prince, the Khan of Kazan, warned that Russia's new prince was born a monster.
A sovereign has been born to you, and he already has two teeth. With one, he will devour us. With the other, he will devour you.
The tyrant history would remember as Ivan the Terrible had been born. But almost from birth, young Ivan was a prisoner of the Kremlin and its intrigues. The death of his father Vasily, when Ivan was only three, set off a deadly power struggle. The young Grand Prince watched as Russia's powerful noblemen, the boyars, fought for control. Moscow's high priest, the Metropolitan, was battered and broken before his eyes.
The boyars ruled. They ruled very poorly. Each one of these cliques tried to steal as much as possible, to grab as much property as possible, to break the treasury.
Between his birth and by the time he came of age, in 1547, and became crowned Tsar, there are at least 14 murders that took place.
Bitter intrigues swept the Kremlin. Even Ivan's mother, his crown regent, may have been a victim. She died when he was just seven, poisoned, some claimed, by rivals trying to seize the powers of the throne. As he came of age in a climate of violence, Ivan soon showed a cruel streak.
When he became an adolescent, he was quite wild. Sometimes he would amuse himself by throwing dogs and cats out of the belfry of the Ivan the Great Cathedral. So the cruelty had been nurtured in him from his childhood.
Whenever he could, he escaped outside the Kremlin. He hunted, he read, and he plotted his revenge. According to some accounts, it was at a Christmas banquet in 1543 that the 13-year-old prince made his first deadly play for power. As rival boyars gorged themselves, the young Prince Ivan stood up and accused the powerful Shuisky family and others of treachery. "You have all conspired to steal my throne," the boy said. "But I will be satisfied if one among you, Prince Andrei Shuisky, is punished."
He had a kennel and he kept dogs. And one time, when Andrei Shuisky was walking in the Kremlin, Ivan told the kennel master to sic the dogs on him. And the dogs ripped Prince Shuisky apart.
Shuisky's death was Ivan's warning to boyars who dared usurp his powers. If wearing the crown called for terror, Ivan was ready, ready to reign with a ruthless hand, even if it called for blood. Murder, intrigue, treachery. Prince Ivan of Moscow came of age watching boyars wage a ruthless struggle for the power of his crown. When the time came to claim his birthright, the Grand Prince made it clear. The boyar struggle was over. The crown and the power belonged to Ivan alone. January 1547. The cathedrals of the Kremlin glittered with splendor for the coronation of Ivan Vasilievich. Not content to be crowned merely Grand Prince, 16-year-old Ivan reached into the past for the authority of an emperor. He resurrected a title used only occasionally by his grandfather, Ivan the Great, the old Russian word for Caesar, Tsar.
The formal adoption of a coronation ceremony of Ivan IV as Tsar was part of the process of transition from a Muscovite principality to a Russian empire.
The term Tsar is not an official title. It's not going to become an official title for the Russian rulers, the Muscovite rulers, until Ivan the Terrible in 1547.
The first prince formally crowned Tsar, Ivan's imperial title echoed the awesome scope of his realm. From the Ural Mountains at Europe's eastern edge to the headwaters of the great Dnieper and Volga rivers, Russia already spanned close to 1 million square miles, twice as large as England, France, and Spain combined. And across all that land, one man reigned supreme. Under Ivan, all power was concentrated in the hands of the Tsar. The aristocracy held no hereditary land or power. The nobles, called boyars, owed their post and authority directly to Tsar Ivan.
Nobody had any individual rights that he was born with. These people, boyars, they were made by the state, appointed by the state, and if the ruler felt like it, could be removed by the state. And everybody knew it.
The Tsar's powers were absolute, a tradition Ivan's successors would defend to the death of the Russian Empire.
If we are to say that our people still, to this day, have some affinity for the monarchy, the foundation for this was laid by Ivan the Terrible. He preached the ideology of autocracy.
Even with all Russia at his command, Ivan wanted more. He dispatched armies to expand his dominion, east and west. Under its new Tsar, the land commonly called Muscovy would become a nation of nations, a true empire.
Usually when one talks about empire, one talks about absorbing other kingdoms and making them part of one's own dominion. And that's what Russia really did for the